Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the fifth annual Kwanzaa, presented by the Friends of the James Brown African American Room and the Newark Public Library. This is our fifth Kwanzaa. And as you know, Kwanzaa was developed in 1966 by Dr. Milana Karanga. I had an opportunity to meet Dr. Karanga in person in the early 1980s. Then principal librarian James Brown, not the singer, but the librarian, James Brown brought Dr. Karanga to the Newark Public Library to celebrate Kwanzaa. It was a great event. I was there. There was food and dancing and inspiring words from Dr. Karanga. However, a few years after that, due to budget cuts and the death of our beloved James Brown in 1991, the Kwanzaa celebrations at the library ceased for many years. Mm-hmm. But then the Friends of J-Bar, we restored this important tradition back onto the library's calendar. We plan to have an in-person event for you tonight, but due to COVID restrictions, I know we're all sick of COVID, but yeah. It had to be changed to virtual. Unfortunately though, I want you all to have faith. We will be back. We'll be back with our in-person events soon. And with your help and support, 2022 will be our year of return. So I need all of you to commit to visiting our Facebook page or the library's website and make it your business to become a friend of the James Brown African American Room for 2022. We provide you with advance notice of all our events, and you're welcome to make suggestions and to participate in some of our programs. And we only ask that you pay a yearly membership fee of $35. So hopefully after this program, some of you will take me up on that offer. Yeah. And visit us become a member of the Friends of J-Bar.
Definitely.
Okay?
Yeah.
Later on in the program, Brother Ali McBride is going to discuss the principles of Kwanzaa with you in a candlelight and ceremony. But for now, I want to take a few minutes to focus on the fifth principle of Kwanzaa, Nia. It means purpose. Dr. Karanga deliberately used key Swahili words for all of the principles of Kwanzaa. And Nia means purpose in Swahili. Every year since we've been celebrating Kwanzaa, we've attempted to incorporate some African culture into our American lives. Dr. Karanga thought that this was important. This year though, I want to share a little African spirituality into our discussion. As you all know, belief systems vary all over the world. And I personally find it very exciting and interesting to read up on some of them. The purpose of Kwanzaa originally, as stated by Dr. Karanga, was to connect us with our past culture, our past African culture. So Ifa is a belief system. It's quite well known in Nigeria among the Yoruba people, and it spread across the Atlantic with the slave trade. In Cuba and Puerto Rico, it is called Santeria, and it's called Xango in Trinidad and Tobago. And in Brazil, I had the opportunity to visit Brazil once, and they call it Candomblé. And I was actually able to see some of the Candomblé services. Mm. So in Haiti, it's called Voodoo. So it's Ifa is widely spread across the country, across the world. Some African scholars even claim that it closely resembles the belief system of ancient Egypt, which predates Christianity, as you all know. One of the things that fascinated me about Ifa was that it has its own creation story. And that creation story gives us a collective, tells us about a collective purpose. That is why I chose to share this with you tonight. I'm going to take a few minutes to share this story, the creation story, with you, mainly because it talks about our collective purpose. So the creation story goes like this. In the beginning, there was heaven and water. Olodumare, the Yoruba name for God, he would look from his favorite seat up in heaven, look down at the water and ponder what to do with this. And then one day he decided to create Earth. Living in heaven with Olodumare were the Orisha, and all of the Orisha had some power, but Olodumare was all powerful. Olodumare sent one of his most trusted Orisha, Obatala, to do the work of creating Earth. Olodumare provided the tools that he would need, and Obatala was sent to Earth with on one shoulder he had a five-toed hen, and on the other shoulder he had a bag of dirt, and he came down from heaven on a gold chain that was provided by Olodumare, and the chain went all the way down to the water. And when he got down to the very last link of the chain, he put the bag of dirt, piled it up on top of the water, and then put the five-toed hen on the other, the five-toed hen on top of the dirt. And when the hen spread his toes, he scattered the dirt and created five continents.
Okay.
So, and I'm telling you this story now because I had a little hesitation, but I found, it's another story. I can deviate for a minute because I got this story from a friend when I was visiting the Bahamas. He gave me a photocopy of a chapter in a book. And I read it and it was so interesting. And then when I tried to look for the book that it came out of, I couldn't find it. But just recently, in the last few weeks, one of our capable, of the many very capable librarians that we have at the North Public Library, Alicia was able to find the book that this creation story came from. So I said, okay, you'll know I'm not making it up. It came out of a book. So I'm sharing it with you now. So when Obatala got down and he put the hen on and created the five continents, he went back up to heaven. When the earth had sufficiently dried, Olodumare set about decorating Earth. And I like to think of him as sitting back with a canvas and painting and saying, I'll put some mountains over here and I'll put a lake over here and I'm gonna put some big old tall trees, maybe those redwood trees over here. But it took him 5 days to finish Earth. And then some of the other Orisha that lived in heaven with Olodumare, they came and explored Earth. They came down. They were the first to walk on Earth. They came to explore Earth. And they would come and go from heaven. There are different stories about how they came. Some stories that I've read said they came down from heaven on spider webs. Nobody said that they came down on a gold chain like Obatala. Okay, but there's various stories. You have to read up on this. But anyway, when Well, after many years had passed, one of God's Orisha, his name was Ebi. Ebi was jealous of God, and he introduced evil into heaven. He became jealous and envious of Olodumare. He said, why should Olodumare be all powerful? I want that. So one day while the Creator slept, Ebi attempted 666 times to usurp the Olodumare's breath. Olodumare, though, caught him in the act. And because Olodumare cannot kill. It's just not in his nature. He cannot. He decided to banish evil. Was 666, his new name. He decided to banish him from heaven. And he was sent to earth to live a life of solitude.
Okay.
Well, after much time had passed, evil became so enraged, living in solitary confinement, that he tried to destroy earth. He said, Olodumare can create, but I can destroy. And that's what he tried to do. He devastated forests and he polluted rivers in the air, and he shattered mountains, and he wreaked havoc on Olodumare's creation. And that's when Olodumare decided to create human beings, to come to earth to fight evil. And we all know what evil is, but this is our purpose here. Evil is destruction, cruelty, hatred, lies, discrimination, injustice, all those things. You know what evil is. Fighting evil on earth is our collective purpose here. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So our purpose is to create heaven on earth. We have two individuals with us tonight who have not only help with our collective purpose, but they found their individual purpose to fight evil. And they're going to share their journey leading them to their individual purpose. And Dale is going to introduce our first panelist, Larry Ham.
Thank you, Dr. Mai. Good evening. Just want to thank everyone for joining us this evening. Lawrence Ham has been a relentless advocate for African Americans and the cause of human rights and civil rights for all oppressed people for nearly 50 years.
Yes.
Raised in Newark, New Jersey, he attended public schools and emerged at age 17 as a forceful and articulate spokesperson for the educational needs and aspirations of Newark students and the community. He was appointed to the Newark Board of Education, making him at that time the youngest voting school board member in the United States. He is a founder and current chairman of the People's Organization for Progress, POP, a statewide independent grassroots organization. POP works for racial, social, economic justice, and peace. As chairman, Brother Ham has consistently worked toward building unity among community organizations. Under his leadership, POP conducted a 381-day campaign of daily protests for jobs, peace, equality, and justice. This year, Brother Ham was included on Insider New Jersey's 2021 African American Political Power List, and most recently, he was included on the 2021 Insider New Jersey 100 Power List. Brother Ham is in demand as a public speaker and has addressed audiences throughout the United States and in other countries. He is the proud father of three daughters, all of whom are college graduates. Please join me in welcoming Brother Lawrence Ham.
There we go. Thank you very much.
Habari Gani.
And today is Nia.
Nia, purpose.
That's right. The greeting during Kwanzaa. As you know, during Kwanzaa, we celebrate the seven principles, and on each of the 7 days, we observe a different principle. So the traditional greeting on a day of Kwanzaa would be a Badigani. And then the person would reply whatever the principle was for that day. Okay. So the principle for today is Nia, purpose. And just to go through the definition, how Dr. Karanga defined it, Nia, to make our collective vocation the building and developing of our community in order to restore our people to their traditional greatness. And I'll leave it there with Nia because I know Brother Ali is going to take us through all seven of the principles. I just want to talk a little bit about Kwanzaa and how I came to Kwanzaa and what I have seen happen with Kwanzaa over the past 50 years. As was stated in the introduction, I was a student in Newark Public Schools at Arts High School. And in 1971, I led a protest fighting evil, Dr. Anasa Ma'at, fighting evil. I led a protest at age 17, a walkout at my school, Arts High School. And we marched down to what was called then the Gateway Hotel. It's called the Doubletree, same building, down there today. And about 400 of us walked out and about 200 of us sat in at the Gateway. And as a result of that sit-in, Mayor Gibson came to talk with us, the students. And as a result of that meeting, to make a long story short, I was appointed to the Board of Education at age 17 on July 1st, 1971. I was not a student representative. I was one of the nine voting members of the Newark School Board. And at that time, I wasn't even old enough to vote because remember, it wasn't until later on that year that the Constitution was amended so that 18-year-olds could vote. We take it for granted now, but that was a struggle. And it had a lot to do with the war in Vietnam because people said, if I'm old enough to be drafted and fight in Vietnam, I should be old enough to vote. Yeah. And so young people won the right to vote that same year, 1971, that amendment was passed. But shortly after I was appointed to the board, it was in August of 1971 that I met Amiri Baraka. I actually had my first sit-down meeting with Amiri Baraka. And Amiri Baraka is very much connected to Kwanzaa. As Dr. Ma'at pointed out, the founder of Kwanzaa is Dr. Maulana Karanga. Dr. Karanga was the head of the US organization in Los Angeles in 1966. And together with the members of US, he developed the Kwanzaa observance, the Kwanzaa cultural observance. Now, Kwanzaa is not a religious holiday. It is a non-sectarian, non-religious cultural observance. And Dr. Karanga was the head of an organization called the Congress of African People, and they practiced a form of Black nationalism called Kaweida. And the core of the Kaweida doctrine is the Nguzo Saba, the seven principles. So in the mid-1960s, Dr. Karanga and Amiri Baraka, then Amir Baraka, got together, and Brother Baraka, that is the father of the current mayor of Newark, Ras Baraka, decided to join with Dr. Karanga, and he became a member of Dr. Karanga's organization and founded a branch of that organization in Newark called the Committee for Unified Newark, CFUN, 502, as people called it in the streets, because it was at 502 High Street, which literally was down across the street from my high school, one block down. I had to pass their headquarters every day. And the brothers would be standing out there, you know, at attention with their arms crossed, and students would walk by and they would say, Habadigani. We didn't know what to say because we didn't know that was Swahili. So we called them the Habadigani people, you know. But I met with Brother Baraka in August of 1971. And our friendship started then and continued until he left us in 2014. So Kwanzaa was started in Los Angeles with Dr. Karanga, but to a great degree, it spread throughout the East Coast because of Amiri Baraka, who at that time was called Imamu Amiri Baraka. And Brother Baraka had Kwanzaa celebrations at his headquarters. Now, he had two headquarters in 1971. One was 502 High Street, and the other one was 13 Belmont Avenue, which is today known as Irvin Turner Boulevard. Now, the headquarters at 502 High Street was called Ikalu Umoja, which meant House of Unity. The headquarters on Irvin Turner Boulevard was called Ikalu Imwalimu, which meant Temple of the Teacher. And it was in December of 1971 that I attended my first Kwanzaa celebration. And if you had stopped people in the street and said you were going to a Kwanzaa celebration, people were like, well, what's that? You know, most people didn't know what Kwanzaa was 50 years ago in 1971. And so there was an auditorium at the Ikalu Imwalimu, and the celebration was there. And there might have been 25 or more people at the time at that Kwanzaa celebration. That might have been the only Kwanzaa celebration in the state of New Jersey. I won't say on the East Coast, because I know in New York, there was another group associated with Karanga called the East. You remember Dr. Ma'at?
The I
East
remember.
Over there in Brooklyn?
I was there,
brother,
yeah.
Yes, Brother G2 Weyusi, big yeah. Black. And we stood in a circle, and I can't, you know, it's hard to describe in words how I felt. You know, it's not easy to make these transitions from the old to the new, from the conventional to the unconventional. And, you know, I was struggling like a lot of other people, you know, with traditions and Christmas and all of that stuff. But I was there at the first Kwanzaa celebration at the invitation of Brother Baraka. And Dr. Ma'at, I'll never forget this. They sang a song at the Kwanzaa celebration, a Kwanzaa song. And the person who led the singing was Amina Baraka, Amiri Baraka's wife. And I'll never forget that. So I'm not going to try and sing it because I'm not a singer. But I will tell you.
Maybe
what
that's Marion's song. Yeah.
I'll tell you what the words were. CC Watu Weusi Watu Wazuri Pamoya Tutashinda. We are Black and beautiful people, and together we will win. Mm. I heard those words in December of 1971. It might have been on this date when it was during the Kwanzaa week. I have never, ever forgotten those words. I remember those words. In fact, I can remember them easier than I can remember the Nguzu Saba.
Wow.
And those few words were imprinted on my heart. We are Black. We are an African people. As much as some of us still in the 21st century try to deny it, we are an African people. We are Africans here in the Americas. And we are influenced by this particular culture, but we're still an African people. And unfortunately, we still have been taught to hate ourselves. Now, I always think of what Brother Malcolm X said. You can't hate the roots of a tree.
That's right.
And not hate the tree.
That's right.
You can't hate the, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know, and a lot of us, I mean, it just disturbs me. And I don't want anybody to take this personally, but I can remember when I was a kid reading like Sepia. Y'all remember Sepia magazine and Ebony? Sepia was like the competition to Ebony magazine. And they had them skin bleaching creams in there, you know?
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Yes. I mean, like full plate page advertising. And back then, they called it what it was. Skin bleaching.
Skin bleaching.
You know? Today, they call it toner. Skin toner. And other things. And what disturbs me is that practice is very much it very much has a grip on our people all over the world, in Africa, in the Caribbean, and here in the United States, mm-hmm. that we're still, you know, we've still internalized our oppression to a degree. Mm-hmm. And we still have to struggle against that. We are Black and we should be proud of being Black. We are a great people. Despite whatever the challenges we have today, we are great people. This moment here in the Western Hemisphere, you know what it is in the sands of time? It's just a few grains in the sands of time. We were rulers of the world some thousands of years ago. And as you can see, when you look around, we are ascending to leadership all over the world today. We are great people, and whatever challenges we have, through unity and through action, we can overcome them. We are Black, we are beautiful people, and together we can win. Now, all of us have, to a degree, self-efficacy. You know, if you're dissatisfied with something, you can write to your congressman, you could send a text, you could send an email, you could call your city council person. You have agency as an individual. But I think what we all learn is that as individuals, we can only go but so far. But collectively, together, we can go the whole distance. It was through a collective effort on our part that we struggled against slavery for over 400 years, 400 years in the Western Hemisphere. I mean, 500 years, if you want to count from the time Columbus took the first enslaved people, the indigenous, 400 in the Western Hemisphere, 245. If it wasn't for our collective effort, slavery would not have been overcome. If it wasn't for our collective effort, Jim Crow would not have been overcome. And Dr. Mott, you and I both know that Jim Crow wasn't just a Southern phenomenon. Oh, no. Jim Crow was right here in Newark, New Jersey.
Right here in Newark, New Jersey.
Right here in Newark, New Jersey. Let me tell you something. Let me tell you about not something what I read, but what I experienced. We talk about the five students at the Woolworth lunch counter. There was a Woolworths in Newark. Mm-hmm. Right there on the corner of Broad and Market was Woolworths. Yeah. And do you know that you could go in the Woolworths store? I don't know if y'all remember.
I remember.
A TV show on called The Rebel with Johnny Yuma, and he was a Confederate soldier, and he wore a little gray Confederate cap. You could go down into the Woolworths and buy that Johnny Yuma Confederate soldier cap with the Confederate flag on. I used to go to Columbus Day parades in Newark, where they openly sold the Confederate flag. You know them little flags that they sell on the souvenir thing? Yes, they sold the Confederate. I'm telling you what I saw. I'm not telling you what I read. They sold Confederate flags and the American flag in Newark, New Jersey. You know, just look at the White Castle there on Elizabeth Avenue. White Castle back in the 50s would sell you a hamburger, but Black people couldn't work there. Mm. And it took a demonstration just to get White Castle to hire Black people. CORE, Congress of Racial Equality, led that demonstration. We wouldn't have had Black power in Newark without our collective effort and the election of Ken Gibson. And we've had 40 years of Black power since then. Over 50 years of Black power since then. And in terms of the challenges for the future, it will take our collective effort, our working together. And it's difficult to work together. Somebody help me here. Ain't it difficult to work together?
Yes, sir. Yes, it is.
Right.
Even this little event put together.
Yes, difficult. Right. You be trying to work with people and egos get involved. And
that's the problem.
Crazy sometimes. But you got to stick with it. Mm-hmm. You got to stick with it. That's why they call it a struggle. That's why they call it a struggle. Mm-hmm. You got to stick with it and work it out. It's hard. You know, but imagine how hard it was for our ancestors to fight against chattel slavery. I mean, all the odds were against them, but they fought anyway. So we must have purpose to make our collective vocation the building of our communities, making them more beautiful than when we inherited them, and reclaiming our traditional greatness. And just let me close here and say two things. One, Dr. Karanga is still very much alive. He has not joined the ancestors.
No.
Right.
He writes an annual Kwanzaa message every year. And I urge people to go to the official Kwanzaa website. I think that's what it's called, the official Kwanzaa website, and read Dr. Karanga's message for this year. He's very, you know, I see a lot of stuff with Kwanzaa and a lot of people putting their own twists on Kwanzaa, but I'm advising people, go to the source. Return to the source, as Amakar Cabral said, and see what the creator of Kwanzaa is saying in this day. And then the second thing is, Dr. Mott, you said something to me. You said something in your presentation that went straight to my heart. You said we must fight evil. And I am 100% with you on that. We must fight evil. But then you said we must fight evil so that we can build heaven on earth. Now, that really stuck with me. Let me tell you why, and I'll shut up after this. I learned recently, right, about the whole complex. You know, we think of the Sphinx as one thing and the pyramids as something else, but it's really a whole complex. The Sphinx, the pyramids, the temple, all of that is together. And there's a whole school of thought now that says that the Sphinx is much older than we are taught in our history books. In fact, some archaeologists—
We're not taught that in our history books.
That's right. Right. But some archaeologists think that the Sphinx may be actually as old as 15,000 years, and that it was built over on several different occasions. But one of the archaeologists did this. You know the constellation Orion? Well, the Egyptians didn't call it Orion.
Right.
Orion was the Greek.
That's right.
The constellation was called Osiris.
That's right.
Egyptian.
And you look, what one of the distinguishing features of the constellation of Osiris or Orion, whichever you choose, are the three stars in the belt. Well, this archaeologist took astronomy and took archaeology and put them together. And what he did is that he positioned the stars, because you know the stars move. Everything in the universe is moving. It
That's
feels
right.
like it's standing still, but we are moving. In fact, we're moving at a pretty fast pace.
Right.
But he positioned the stars to where they were about 15,000 years ago. And the three stars in the belt of Orion line up exactly with the location, the placement of the three pyramids at Giza. And the thing that he was trying to tell us was that when the Egyptians built this complex, they were trying to build heaven on earth.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr.
Okay. Well, hey, you guys have really got to go and read that creation story that I shared with you. It lays it all out for you. So we have a lot to build on. We just have to get up on the shoulders of those who came before us.
That's right.
Okay? Thank you, Larry. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Now, it is going to be my pleasure and honor to introduce our second panelist, Miriam Bay. Okay. Miriam is the founder and CEO of Tell a Vision, the TV show. And she's author of a book that she recently published called Broken Spirit, Let It Go So You Can Grow. Let It Go So You Can Grow. She's a passionate person, especially about her work and her career as director of Creative Garden School Incorporated, a community school. She owned and operated it for 10 years in the city of Newark. She was a North Public Schools board member when I was a board member. She was there before me, and she was president from 2001 to 2004. She does reentry counseling now, working with those behind the walls of the Kentuck Group, Delaney Hall, and Essex County Correctional Facility. Edna Mahon Women's Prison and the City of Newark Reentry Coordinator. Miriam discovered her purpose, assisting and empowering her clients to discover theirs. She graduated from St. Peter's College with a BS, and she has an AAS degree in urban education and public policy. So let me tell you, it is my pleasure to introduce Miss Miriam Bay.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay. Now, Larry, you know, you are a great historian. No matter where I go, when you get up and speak, that's like the end of it. The end. You are so magnificent. And I remember all the stuff that you did. And thank you so much for all that you've done collectively to help us. You know, and Anasa, I'm so honored that you asked me to come on and speak. And I remember our brother James Brown and the great things that he did when he was here, and all the history that he gave us by, you know, working in the library. And today, the purpose. That the reason why I'm here is because of the purpose or NIA. And when I was going over the purpose, you know, Larry, how sometimes people ask you to do things and they're like, they've asked you like a lot of times before, but for some reason with this one, Anasa called me and asked me to do this on purpose. I said, you know what? I gotta go back to my childhood now, because see, purpose is real powerful. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, we all have a purpose. The Creator has given us all a purpose. We just have to find it going through the process. And with everything that Black folks have gone through in this country, it's amazing that we're able to find and discover our purpose. So I went back to my little girl days, right? And I remember three things about what I love to do. The first thing was like, I love babysitting, right? That was my first job, babysitting. And then the second thing I liked to do was writing. I love writing stories and everything. And so my classmates will always ask me, could you write a story for me? Could you do this? I love doing that. And then the last thing that I liked doing was singing. You know, I sang at the Apollo Theater. We came in second place and everything. You know, yes. Yeah, so I thought I was going to be the next Diana Ross. But here's the thing. When we're talking about collective stuff, the Creator knows what He has for us. So spirituality for me is so important. Because as you said, Larry, earlier, you know, it's difficult to work with a lot of us. And we have to have the right spirit in order for us to work together and say, I forgive you and keep moving on, you know, because if we don't do that, we miss our gifts and what the Creator has for us, like what the Creator has done for you. You're living your purpose, you know, by being out here fighting for our people for over 50 years, right? So for me, my purpose was, and another word for purpose for me is called gift, because our singing, our preaching, our dancing, our teaching, that all of those are gifts, like the gifts that you have to communicate. Like, you are a great communicator, Larry. So that's a gift. If we don't use the gifts that the Creator has given us, we lose it. We lose it. And when we were born, the Creator knew what we were born for. And through life experiences, we go through a whole lot of stuff. But in going through the stuff that we go through, we're discovering who we are. So for me, fast forwarding, I owned and operated the school for 10 years. We were very, very successful with that school. I closed it in 1984. I opened it in when I was 24 and closed it when I was 34. And when I closed it, it was because I was going through a divorce. Nothing happened. It was because I was going through a divorce and I didn't want any negativity to come on the school. And I said, if the Creator wanted me to do this, he will do it for me in the future. As a result, I became the member of the Newark Public Schools and then Newark Public Schools board member, president, right? Thankful again to someone who we all mentioned this evening, Mayor Gibson, right? So, and then after that, I started, you know, creating conferences and different things like that. And so then I said, you know what, I need to, wherever I went, I was always passionate about it because my passion is helping people. And it's also helping those who are in pain, so to speak. And so when I wrote my book, Broken Spirit, Let It Go So You Can Grow, the reason why I called it that is because I was a broken spirit too. So when I started working in a prison system for the last 20 years, and this is what my book is about, when I started working in a prison system, I said, whoa, these brothers and sisters, they are broken. How do we help them? Or how do I help them? And as a result of doing that, how I helped them was through all of the experiences that I went through. Because you cannot help anyone if you haven't gone through something. And one of the things that I realized is that we had to empower these brothers and sisters. Because, you know, when you talked about evil, the prison industrial system is evil. It's evil. What it has done to our people is evil. And today it continues to be evil because when they get brothers and sisters behind the walls, instead of them rehabilitating them, they're destroying them. They're making them worse than what they were when they came in. They're abusing them, okay? They're physically abusing them, sexually abusing them, men and women. They did all that. They're doing all of that. So that's evil. So when I was working inside, when I saw that, I fought against it. I fought against it on a regular basis, okay? But then I recognized the brothers and sisters who were coming to me, they would say things like, well, you know, Miss Bay, I can't read. Oh, you can't read? That goes back to the educational system. So there's a direct relationship between education and incarceration.
Definitely.
Because a lot of the brothers and sisters that I work with, mainly men, that I worked with, they were high school dropouts, okay? And then I saw the relationship between education, or I should say miseducation and incarceration. So anyway, what I decided to do was, as I was investing in myself, coming up and everything, buying books, going to conferences and listening to people. You guys remember Dr. Amos Wilson, that powerful brother, right? The kinds of things that he was talking about, the psychological development of the Black child, right? So I started using all of that information that came to me when I was in the Nation of Islam with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad gave to us as well. Collectively as a people to help and build our brothers and sisters, that was given to the brothers and sisters when I was working inside, and that continues to happen today. And as a result, I say that all of my experiences was contributed my success to as a reentry specialist and counselor was the fact that I used tapes, I used information, I brought brothers and sisters in to let the brothers and sisters who were broken, to let them understand that you're not by yourself. And all of us go through this or we grow through it. Because whenever we're going through stuff, we are growing through it. And one of the things that I learned, which is real, real important to me, was the fact that brothers and sisters inside are always being judged or misjudged. But when you hear their stories, you understand why they are where they are or were. And they need collectively people like us who will not judge and help them and help to inspire them to be their best selves, because that is what the Creator wanted want us all to be, those who are behind the walls. The brothers and sisters who are behind the walls are so creative. They are so powerful. They are so smart. And so when I was working behind the walls, I was excited about changing the lives of the brothers and sisters behind the walls. And I just feel, you know, overwhelmed that with the little that I had, I was able to do so much. Example, when I had my school, I had a young man there, his name was Jason, and he wanted to be an architect. Today, Jason is an architect. He has his own company. Yes, that was through the powerful staff that we had working with the students at Creative Garden School. Today, when I think about the brothers that I worked with behind the walls, we have a brother by the name of Chris Stokes, who is now a brother who is working with other brothers, you know, inside. And he is an example, or I would say he is a testimony of success. Because in his testimony, he was able to show the brothers who were in prison that you don't have to stay where you are. Because here's the thing, it is a choice. See, we can go ahead and make excuses and everything and blame people for where we are, because just think about it, Larry. If we focus on blaming what white folks did to us in slavery, where will we be today? Where will we be today if it was just that focus and not the focus on building our people up? You know, the Kwanzaa principles, without all of that, where would we be? So we have to let brothers and sisters know, okay, this happened to you 10, 15, 20 years ago. Okay, that's fine, we got that. But what you gonna do right now? And then they need to have the help. And that's where we come in collectively to give them the help in order for them to be who they were destined to be. I wanna mention something about Malcolm X. Malcolm X, I know you remember this. He went to California back in the, I think it was the 60s, in the 70s, because there were some brothers who were killed by the police. And so he went there, not as Big Red, but now as Malcolm X, the minister. So while he was going there, the media was portraying him as Big Red. And so Malcolm got up and he said, "Being a criminal, I am not embarrassed by that." He said, "Remaining the criminal is the embarrassment." And look at who he became.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
You know, so I am just honored and thankful to the Creator, because we're all going through something with this coronavirus and everything. We don't know what people are going through. And with us going through what we're going through, we have to, well, this is what I do for myself. I have to rely on the Creator for his guidance or her guidance, because there's no way I could do what I am doing and will continue to do, you know, continue to do without the support of the Creator. Mm-hmm.
So Mariam, are you ready to go into your song now?
Let me do it right now. Okay.
Okay.
So the reason why I wanted to sing this song is because we're just going through so much, and I just want people to know that everything is going to be all right. You know, we're going to be good because we have the tools. We are standing on strong shoulders.
No, just get up there. Just get up there on those shoulders.
Yes, we got it. We got it. So here's a song by The Sound of Blackness. Can you all hear it? Can you hear that? All right.
Ooh, yeah.
Wow. Oh, yeah.
Here we go.
Here we go now.
Sing a little message out.
Think you're struggling. Come, it's gonna be all right. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a simple song. La la di da di da di da da. Now, yesterday, a man said to me, he said, how can you smile when your world is crumbling down? I said, here's my secret. When I wanna cry, I take a look around and I see that I'm getting by and I hold on. Change is coming. Hold on. Don't you worry. Hold on. Come on now. You can make it. Hold on. Everything. Some people like to worry. Don't worry. Some people like to hide. Some people like to run away from the pain inside. Now it's your business. Do whatever you want to do. But if it don't work out, here's what you ought to do. Now just hold on. Yes, hold on. A change is coming.
It's coming.
Hold on. Don't worry. Everything's gonna be all right.
Oh, that was great, Marianne. Thank you so much. You sounded like Gladys Knight, my husband told me to tell you.
Okay.
Okay, so now to do our last person here, panelists, we're going, not panelists, but our candlelighting expert.
I'm an expert.
He's done this now for Friends of J-Bar Kwanzaa's, I think, since our inception. Ali McBride has been a friend from our inception in 2016. He was there, and we are now 5 years old, and he's been doing our Kwanzaa celebrations, candle lighting since then. So he is going to do that for you right now.
Good evening. Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Ekale o, Masa Alker. Ekale o is Yoruba. Masa Alker is Wolof, and Masa Alker is Arabic. And I'm saying that because I actually visited all three of those countries. So that's part of my purpose.
Okay.
And what's up, everybody? But before I move forward, we're going to, I don't think you did this because we had technical difficulties. That's why I wasn't on in the beginning, but did anybody ask for permission to move forward?
Yes.
No? Oh. Who's the oldest? Who's the oldest on the panel?
Me.
Wait a minute, how old are you?
I ain't telling you. I'm older than Larry though, and I know he was born in 1953.
Oh, well, I was born in 1951.
Well, you know what?
Well, I ain't telling you when I was born.
Out of respect, I'll ask everybody, the elders, period.
Okay, I'm an elder.
I'm an elder.
And I'm the oldest.
Do I have permission to move forward?
Yes, you have my permission.
Ashe, thank you. And really quickly, we're going to do, because I know we're crunching time. What I want to do first and initially is I want to pour some libations for the ancestors.
Yeah.
Because whenever we do something, we need to acknowledge the ancestors, acknowledge the elders as I have done, and also acknowledge our ancestors. So I have my
libation.
Tukomba cha umoja. I have my cup, all right? So I'm about to pour libations. And what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna just do it consistently. So I'm gonna start with my ancestors. And as I pour, I want you all to name ancestors that have gone on to the ancestral realm. All right, okay. So I'll begin. I'm going to begin with Mary McBride, Ibaye. Y'all can name some. Name them. Go ahead and start naming them. Al McBride Sr., Ibaye.
Robert Fasher.
There you go, Ibaye.
Lula Eccles.
Willie McBride, Ibaye.
Okay.
Gene Colston.
There you go, Ibaye. Blanche Booker, Ibaye. Rose Salters, Ibaye. Name some, y'all got more ancestors than that now. Rose Salters.
Cunningham, now my Ibaye. Ancestor.
There you go.
My cousin just died about 10 minutes ago.
Oh, wow.
Ibaye, Kevin Salters, Ibaye. Elliot Elias Salt is Ibaye. Kadon Cotton Ibaye. Marquise Cotton Ibaye. Y'all can keep naming. Now, unless that's just my ancestors. Y'all got ancestors. I do. You say I do this every year. Every year, everybody should know that I'm gonna always ask the elders for respect to move forward, and I'm going to name ancestors that we pour libations to open this thing up. All right. So everybody should know that, right?
Right.
All right. So I said Kevin Salters, Elliot, Anasa. You know anybody else in your family?
Bill Cunningham.
Hey, Ashe. Keep going. Ashe.
Who was David? Cunningham.
Paul Colston.
Ashe. All right. And I'll finish it up. Ibaye. Ashe. Okay. We're going to go to the candle lighting ceremony. And as everybody knows, and if you have yours at home, you have your set at home, you know that we have the usual resources. We have our mazeo, which is the fruit and the vegetables. We have our mtika, which is the placemat. I have that behind me. I know my lighting is a little janky, but I got my placemat under everything. All right, and I have my kanara, as you see. I had to fix that up earlier because it was janky as well, but it looks like it's strong now. We have our vibunzi, the ears of corn, to actually have an account of all of the children that are there in presence, right? We have that. We have our zawadi, and zawadi means gifts. Yeah. And when we have gifts, we don't want to go out into Best Buys and buy a PlayStation for our children. We want to do things that are inexpensive and that are more creative. When we're practicing Kaumba, right? Yes. We want to make stuff. We're going to give our books. That's popular. To give our books to read and the Meshuba Samba, which of course are the seven candles. And when we light the candles, which candle do we light first?
The middle one, the black.
So I'm going to do it, but I'm going to keep an eye on it too, because I get, like I said, it's janky. So I'm a light Umoja now.
Make sure it's not touching anything.
No, it's not. I'm good. I got a fire extinguisher not too far from me.
Good.
Okay, we got Umoja going. What is Umoja?
Unity.
Unity, right? We're going to strive for and maintain unity in the family, community, nation, and race. Right. Next up is what?
Kujichagulia.
Kujichagulia is what?
Self-determination.
There you go. To define ourselves, name ourselves, create for ourselves, and speak for ourselves instead of being defined, named, created for, and spoken by others.
Yes.
We're going to go to the far, my left, your right. We're going to hit that red one on the outside, right?
Yeah.
You want to start with the black candle. We're going to go outside. We're going to alternate back and forth. Yeah. What's the third one?
Ujima.
What is Ujima?
Collective work
and responsibility. I help
you. Yes, collective work and responsibility.
Absolutely. Right. So we're going to build and we're going to maintain our community together and make our sisters and brothers' problems our problems and to solve them to what? Together.
Yeah.
Right. What's next? Oh, I got to light the
candle. Ujima.
I'm sorry, it's like that can.
Ujamaa.
Okay, Ujamaa. What is Ujamaa?
Cooperative economics.
Which was yesterday, and God willing, you all went out and you supported businesses of people that look like us.
Yes.
Specifically me, God, I love the source of knowledge. I go and I buy something from the source of knowledge, and I not only do that on that day, Ujamaa, but I do that every time I think about it. You know, I always think about supporting mine as all other people do, because that's just human response.
Yes.
People who are in their collective minds. The sister spoke about Amos Wilson earlier.
Yes.
We are in our minds. Guess what? We're going to support those that look like us.
Yes.
Right? It shouldn't be a problem. Right?
Yes.
So the next one is today, which is the, oh, can we like that? We got to like the other one?
Yes. Right? Nia, like purpose.
There you go. Which is one of the most important behind faith. What is purpose?
Yes. Know your purpose. Find your purpose if you don't know it, but work it too.
Absolutely. And purpose is to make our collective vocation the building and developing of community in order to restore our people to their traditional greatness. And I also want to add to that really quick. I know Baba Ham, who leads the People's Organization for Progress, when we're talking about purpose, one of the big things that they've been involved in, of course, is the Civilian Complaint Review Board. Right? So we need to keep in contact and know that serves our ultimate purpose, the Civilian Complaint Review Board.
Yes.
We know that the Step Rites of Passage program develops our young men, right? We know that. That's one of our purposes, right? Right. Then we have the Newark chapter of the NAACP, where we're fighting different issues that serve the best interest of our people, that serves the best interest of African people.
Right.
Then we have African Echoes, an organization that
talk
about the things that have influenced us and the people like Amos Wilson, like you talked about earlier, Dr. John Henry Clark, Dr. Joseph Binyakinen, you know, all of those individuals. So we want to keep that in front of us, right? But not only do we want to keep those organizations in front of us, guess what? All of those organizations are 501c3 organizations, which means what? That you can donate money. So you're mixing everything up. You're getting creative, Kalumba. You're doing Ujamaa. You're talking about supporting Black businesses, and you donate some money. It doesn't have to be large, because they can't just do this without some type of monetary resource. They need money. So around this time, when you're thinking about it, when you know you shouldn't be eating those Doritos, take that money and send it to one of those organizations, right? They're 501c3 organizations, right? So that, did I light the candle for that one yet?
No, we didn't get there. That's tomorrow.
So we got to do that grant. No, we got to do that one. That was near, right?
Are
so
you now, doing all of them? Okay.
No, you know what? We're going to stop there. Right?
Near purpose.
Right, near. So we're going to stop it near. And I just want to say really quick, a man's hands are his parents. They feed him. Mm. Yoruba proverb.
Yes.
A man's hands are his parents. They feed him. You know, when I went to Nigeria really quick and then I'll end really quick, and all my readings and everything that I needed to do and all of the taboos I needed to know before I was initiated, one thing that they told me that was important, and I had heard that not only from the Baba Babalao, but I also heard that from Boy Strayhorn doing numbers. Make sure I respect my mother, because my mother, right, she's the prize.
Yes.
Make sure I talk to her every day. Mm-hmm. So we make sure we talk to our parents if they're alive every day. We talk to our elders every day. That's our secret weapon.
Yeah.
That's our secret weapon that will lead us to fulfill our purpose. Right?
Yes.
So thank you again. It's fifth anniversary, fifth year. I look forward to doing Kaumba and Imani for the next two. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ali. And I thank all of you for being our panelists today. And hold on, because maybe we might have some questions from the audience. And if so, we can discuss them. But this has been a wonderful Kwanzaa event. I want to thank you all for participating and for being here this evening, taking the time out, even though you quarantine, you can't go nowhere anyway. But we're going to be alive in person in 2022 when we do Kwanzaa. In the meantime, find your purpose. Know that our collective purpose is to fight this evil out here that's trying to keep us from becoming what we know. We did it once, we can do it again.
That's right.
We have to reclaim our rightful place here in this society. So, Dale, do we have any questions?
No, I didn't see any questions. The comments, everyone was happy with the Sister Bay singing. Always inspired.
She has a great voice.
And always inspired by brother. And we're going to move on, but everyone was happy and we're happy that they came and participated with us collectively. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all. We're gonna do some dancing. We're going to fill up the rest of this time with some African dancing. So watch it from your whatever device you're watching it from. Watch the dancing that our library crew, Alicia Grant and Reggie Blanding and them have picked out for us tonight. And thank you again for coming, and happy Kwanzaa.
Happy Kwanzaa
to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Oh,
Dr. Mott, you have any parting words before I talk about our next event? We can't hear you, doctor.
Sorry. No, Dale, why don't you go on with your next event?
And okay.
Then we can sign out.
Okay. Thank you ever so. On behalf of Jocelyn Bowling Dixon, Director of the Newark Public Library, and Dr. Lauren Wells, President, Library Board of Trustees, we thank you all for sharing your evening with us for the 5th annual Friends of the James Brown African American Room Kwanzaa celebration. We hope to see you next year and very soon in person. Please plan to join us on Saturday, January 15th for our annual Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. lecture. I have a feeling this will be virtual, but please plan to join us anyway. Our guest lecturer will be Claudia L. Gordon, Senior Accessibility Strategy Partner, T-Mobile, Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. Ms. Gordon is former Chief of Staff for the United States Department of Labor's Office of Federal Contract Compliance with the Obama Administration. Ms. Gordon is the first Black deaf female attorney in the United States. She indeed found her purpose and made it work. Can you imagine? This is Black excellence right here.
Yes.
Saturday, January 15th, the program will begin at 2 o'clock. Please visit our website and our social media feeds for updated information. Again, I believe this will be virtual. We want everyone to be safe, but you can still join us from the comfort of wherever you might be. Thank you again for joining us on behalf of the library. We thank you for your continued support of the Friends of the James Brown African American Room and the Newark Public Library. Be well, and we'll see you soon.
And don't forget to become a friend in 2022, Friend of the James Brown African American Room, if you are not already a friend. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you ever so. Be well.
Okay. Good night.